Hi, this is Dr. A with Basics of Chemistry. We are going to look at enzymes in this video. So what are enzymes? They are catalysts, meaning they modify the speed of reactions without being used up themselves in those reactions. These catalysts accompany all biological processes in living organisms, or at least nearly all biological processes. And they facilitate those metabolic reactions that happen inside the cells of the body. Enzymes are generally contained inside the cells. So when enzymes are found in the plasma, in the blood, there's a certain level that is considered normal. That will be in our normal reference ranges. But any increase in those levels in the plasma then is indicative of a damage to the cell that was containing the enzyme. Factors that affect enzymes and how they work are multiple. So first, there's the concentration of the substrate. So what is the substrate? The substrate is the molecule or molecules that the enzyme is going to work on to make the product. So you could have a single substrate that an enzyme would be working on to break down into two products, or you could have two substrates that the enzyme is going to work on to bring them together to make one product. And that could be either way. So how much of that substrate is there will dictate how active that enzyme is to make the product. So if there's hardly any substrate, the enzyme will not be very active. If there's a lot of substrate, meaning it needs to make a lot of product, that enzyme will be very active create a lot of product. Then the concentration of the enzyme itself. How much of the enzyme is contained within the cell? For example, on that, there could be some genetic variations, and especially if you look at the detoxification enzymes, and some people have more and then faster detoxifiers, some people have less and they're slower detoxifiers. So concentration of the enzyme will affect its activity. The pH, so enzymes are meant to work at specific pHs depending on their location, and a variation from that pH will cause the enzyme to sometimes work faster, slower, or maybe not at all. Temperature is another factor that affects enzyme activity. So the rule with enzymes, so this is within a specific temperature range, usually an increase in temperature speeds up the action of the enzyme and a decrease in temperature slows it down. So we can relate this to, for example, when there's a fever, the goal of the fever is actually to speed up all the enzymatic reactions that the immune system need to fight off the infection. And so it just makes the body more effective and those enzymes work faster. Now, if the temperature gets too high, so let's say we take an enzyme and we take it out of the body and we boil it, then that can completely destroy the enzyme and make it completely inactive. With cold, it's slowing the activity of the enzyme down. You can actually even freeze the enzyme and it will suspend the activity. And then if you warm it back up, it will simply activate again. And that could be the reason, if you will, behind some people that, like if they fall in cold water and they're down there for a little bit and you can get them back up, well, all their life activities kind of suspend. And usually if you can get them out and warmed up, you can usually bring them back. So this is just a couple of illustrations. You can even see variations in temperature with a basal metabolic rate tied to thyroid function. So when thyroid function is low, body temperature is lower and all the metabolic reactions are slower. When the thyroid is higher, or producing more thyroid hormones and metabolism is higher, then all the reactions happen faster and a person's a little bit more active, even to the point of being a little more anxious. And their body temperature is a little bit higher. So time can affect enzymes. So how long the reaction is going to take, and also, simply the time lapsed for the enzyme activity. The inhibitors. So the inhibitors could be seen as enzyme poisons, things that block the activity of the enzyme. or even could destroy the enzyme. But products can also be inhibitors. So if there's a presence of a lot of substrate, it can turn an enzyme on and make it really active. And then if all that substrate is gone and there's nothing but product, then that product can inhibit that enzyme and essentially basically turn it off because it doesn't need to produce anymore because there's plenty of product there. So let's look at some important enzyme assays. Lactate dehydrogenase, or LDH, the normal range is 100 to 210 international units per liter. LDH is increased in liver, heart, skeletal muscle, in kidney disease, and in the presence of some tumors. LDH is a very nonspecific enzyme because it's contained in so many cells. It's not going to give you very specific information to be able to pinpoint where the injured cells are, where the injured tissue is. But if the physician can figure out what has been injured, then the LDH could be used to track therapy, for example, to track recovery, to see if the LDH that was elevated is coming back down. Most of these enzyme assays that we are looking at in the blood, the concern is, are these enzymes above normal? Because there's a certain amount that is expected to be in blood, but anything that is above normal then is indicative of injury to that cell or that tissue. Creatine kinase, the normal range for males is 40 to 200 international units per liter, and for females is 35 to 150 international units per liter. CK is mostly found in muscles, so they are diagnostic for myocardial infarction, which is a heart attack, and heart's a muscle, so damage to the heart muscle, or muscle disease, muscle injury, anything that, you know, could cause the muscle tissue to be releasing that enzyme. Incidentally, that is also why there's a difference in the ranges. Males have higher muscle mass than females, and therefore they have a higher normal range than females do. The serum CK concentrations will rise sharply 4 to 8 hours after the onset of chest pain that's associated with an acute myocardial infarction. They do peak in 24 hours and then return to normal in 3 to 4 days. However, the CK test, total CK, is really no longer part of a cardiac workup because we do have much better tests for that. You just have to know that if there's any kind of muscle injury, whether it's heart muscle, skeletal muscle, or even smooth muscle, the CK can increase. Next, we have the creatine kinase isoenzyme CKMB. So within CK, because it's contained in all muscles, we've been able to actually pinpoint different subtypes, if you will, of CK. And CKMB is the one that is specific to the heart tissue. So normal range should be less than 12 international units per liter, or less than 3 to 6% of the total CK. It is, of the CK isoenzymes, the most specific for myocardial tissue, so for heart muscle. It has been used in the diagnosis of AMI, and in some facilities, the CKMB is still part of a cardiac workup for patients that present to the ER, but there are some facilities that no longer use it also. The serum CKMB concentration will begin to rise 3 to 12 hours after the onset of AMI, acute MI, or heart attack. And they will peak in 24 hours and return to baseline in 2 to 3 days. One of the usefulness of the CKMB, I'll talk about that also in the cardiac markers one, is that it returns back to normal faster than the other heart assay, which is called a troponin, again, which I'll cover in a different video. And so if there is a second heart attack, a second rise in CKMB could be indicative of re-injury, and so it can be useful. Next, we have aspartate aminotransferase, or AST. The normal range in males is 0 to 37 international units per liters, and for females is 0 to 31 international units per liter. It is increased in viral hepatitis, hepatic carcinoma, and other liver degenerative diseases, because the liver is a big source of AST. It is also elevated in myocardial infarction or a heart attack, because AST is also contained in muscles. And if there is muscle injury, even skeletal muscle injury, it is possible also to see a high AST, because AST is also found in skeletal muscle. And ALT is alanine aminotransferase. Its normal range is 3 to 30 international units per liter. It is increased in diseases of the liver, and it is more liver specific than AST because you don't really see it in muscle. And so they're always tested for together and looked at together to help determine if the rises in AST and ALT are coming from the liver or maybe from a different source. And then alkalinephosphatase, the normal range varies with age and with the assay. And the alkalinephosphatase is elevated in the patients that have bone and liver diseases. So those are the two primary origin of that enzyme. And in liver diseases, alkalinephosphatase is actually contained in the biliary tract. So where bile flows, the lining cells of the bile canals. An elevation in alkalinephosphatase can also occur in late pregnancy because the placenta also contains alkalinephosphatase. And if you think about it too, a pregnant woman is growing a baby that has bones and bones containing alkalinephosphatase. Anyway, with all of that together, it is not unusual to see increased alkalinephosphatase in pregnancy. If there's liver disease, alkalinephosphatase could be increased along with AST and ALT. But if only the alkalinephosphatase is increased and AST and ALT are normal, it's possible that then the origin could be from bone. And that wraps up all of our enzymes. Thank you.